Hello friends, welcome back to another video tutorial from Shomu's Biology, and we are talking about the eukaryotic DNA replication, and this video is all about the elongation of eukaryotic DNA replication. So let me write here elongation of eukaryotic DNA replication. Okay, and the elongation process is not that difficult or not that different elongation. Okay, so the actual process of elongation, what do we mean by elongation? It's simply the polymerization of the newly synthesizing DNA strand. So it's simply as the DNA polymerization. And as I told you earlier, that in eukaryotes, 3000 bases are added per minute by the DNA polymerase, eukaryotic DNA polymerase enzyme. Okay. So this is comparatively slow to compared to the prokaryotic DNA replication rate, which is faster. Now, what we intend to talk here, in the DNA polymerization, there is only a basic law, and that is, you know, we have this, this is, let's say, 3 prime, this is 5 prime. This is only one template strand I'm showing you. And this is where the new DNA is being added, 5 prime to 3 prime. So how it is being added? It's very simple. You know, we have this 3 prime hydroxyl, okay? And we also have the upcoming phosphate, upcoming nucleotide. So this is the nucleotide with 3 phosphate groups added, okay? So this is how the polymerization takes place. Always keep this idea in your mind. So the hydroxyl of the 3 prime is always free, and we need to have this free 3 prime hydroxyl in order to catalyze the polymerization reaction by either the DNA polymerase delta or DNA polymerase epsilon of eukaryotic DNA polymerases. So what they do is that this is a nucleophilic attack, okay? So this attacks the alpha phosphate. This is alpha, this is beta, this is gamma phosphate. So it attacks the alpha phosphate, as a result of which beta gamma phosphate is cleaved out as PPI. And further, this PPI is degraded to 2 inorganic phosphate, and that gives us del G value, which is minus, and as a result, it can drive the reaction forward. So by this fashion, what happens is that this particular nucleotide gets added to the backbone of the newly synthesizing strand of the DNA. So this is how the polymerization is done, and this process is same for prokaryotes, eukaryotes, or any other organism you take. The DNA polymerization process is absolutely the same. You need to have a free 3 prime hydroxyl that will initiate the attack, and you need to have a 3 phosphate, at least 2 phosphate, but in this case always we have 3 phosphate because we have DNTPs, so 3 phosphate groups are always present. Okay, so that is a very basic thing. You know, there's no difference between prokaryotic replication and eukaryotic replication, but the region where difference comes between the prokaryotic and eukaryotic DNA replication elongation is the involvement of some protein. Because, you know, what happened is that in that initiation stage, in that origin of replication site, when the helicase is loaded, helicase is unwrapping, helicase is separating the DNA strands, and they are recruiting the polymerase delta and epsilon in that place. So when the cell recruits polymerase delta and epsilon, that time polymerase alpha already dissociates. It's very, very important. Alpha and delta, or alpha and epsilon, cannot work together at the same time. So polymerase alpha gets dissociated. And once the polymerase alpha is dissociated, then only delta and epsilon are loaded onto. Delta is loaded in the lagging strand, and epsilon is in the leading strand. Okay, so they are loaded. So once they are loaded, then PCNA is also being loaded. And once the PCNA loads, that again checks whether the polymerase dissociates or not, polymerase delta alpha dissociates or not. And once the dissociation is done, PCNA is loaded onto this polymerase delta and as well as epsilon. Because remember, the polymerase alpha not only adds the primer, but also can synthesize up to 20 nucleotides of deoxyribonucleotide addition in the growing chain of the DNA. And then what will happen is that there are two approaches to close down the whole process, because now the leading strand is being synthesized by the DNA polymerase epsilon of eukaryotic polymerase, and the lagging strand is being synthesized by the eukaryotic DNA polymerase delta. But at this moment, both are moving, okay? And at the end, we need to end this process, because, you know, this process will continue until or unless they hit the termination site or termination sequence, or they are going to meet with other replication machinery. Because, you know, in case of eukaryotes, what we have is that if this is the complete DNA and you want DNA replication, it works something like this. There are multiple places where the replication bubble will form, and all of them, they are going to meet one another at a time, okay? And that way the DNA, totally 2 new separate DNA strands will be separated. So this is the idea. So at this moment, you know, at the end of the process of elongation, the very important and interesting fact is how exactly the RNA component is removed. Because, you know, there are multiple problems of the end of the replication in eukaryotes. In prokaryotes, at the end of the replication, we know that the RNA primer, which was added earlier by the primase enzyme, is cleaved out by the DNA polymerase 1, and the gap is also filled by the DNA polymerase 1, because the polymerase 1 has 3 prime to 5 prime exonuclease activity. Also the 5 prime to 3 prime exonuclease, but they use 3 to 5 prime exonuclease activity. And then the DNA ligase will seal the knee. In this case, at the end of this process, apart from this primer removal, there is another big problem, and that is the end replication problem or telomere replication problem. We are going to talk about that in details in the next video about the DNA replication termination of eukaryotes, so eukaryotic DNA replication termination. But now what we intend to talk here is how exactly that RNA primer component can be removed, because the pol alpha adds the RNA primer component. So in this case, there are two processes that can be done. One is the RNA's age method. So let me write here. One is the RNA's age method. Another one is the flap method. Okay. There are these two methods which we can use, which eukaryotic cell can use in order to end or remove or cut out the RNA components from their DNA counterparts. Okay, so how they are going to do that? Okay, for that I want to release, and it is this one, I don't need it. So what I need to talk here is that for this purpose, they need these two separate proteins, RNA's H, okay, and they also have FEN1. Okay, so what's the idea? The RNA's H, the RNA's age model depends on this enzyme only, RNA's age, and flap model depends predominantly on the FEN1 protein. Okay, so what RNA's age is job, what RNA's age can do? RNA's age is an enzyme, it's a ribonuclease, so it can cleave the ribonucleic acid, so ribonucleotide sequences, out from the DNA strands, and that it can do in the regions where the primer is present, both in the leading strand as well as in the lagging strand, both can be done. Okay, so it's very simple. So let me assume, like, this is the template DNA strand, and we have, let's say, this is the primer, okay, and this is the nucleotide sequence. Okay, so what they are going to do is that here, let's assume this is 5 prime, this is 3 prime, so obviously this will be 3, this will be 5 prime. So this RNA's H, okay, RNA's H protein degrades the primer, okay, and it starts to cleave the primer from this side. Okay, so it starts cleaving the primer from this side, it can continue to cleave it till, you know, it can also cleave some of the DNTPs as well. Okay, not only RNTPs, but it can also cleave some of the DNTPs as well. Okay, few of the DNTPs cleavage is fine, and then that gap needs to be filled, and that will be filled by the polymerase delta, because the polymerase delta can essentially be used as a ready to go on polymerase to add nucleotide sequence in leading or lagging strand in any places. Okay, that can be done. On the other hand, in the lagging strand, because the RNA's age mediated process is done in the leading strand only, okay, in the leading strand only, but for the lagging strand where we have multiple primers, okay, so we need to cleave multiple primers out of it. For them, what we have this FEN1, because FEN1 detects the ribonucleotides or ribonucleotide sequences there. Okay, it's very, very important. So what it does actually in this process of flap mediated model, the polymerase delta, because we are talking about the lagging strand now, so polymerase delta is there, polymerase delta and helicase is pushing the primer away. Why we call it as a flap model? Let me explain this to you.
Okay, so now we are at my computer screen, and in this part I'm going to tell you how exactly the flap model works and what is the difference between the RNA's H model with the flap model. So I'll be talking about both. So yeah, first let's talk about the RNA's H model. If you look at the RNA's H model, let me take a color first here. Okay, so in RNA's H model, one thing is clear, this is the new DNA which is being synthesized in red color, and this is the Okazaki fragment written here in the red color. Okay, blue colored new DNA, and this green color section, this is the primer region. Okay, if you recall, So this is the template DNA. This is the newly synthesizing DNA with Okazaki fragment. That's how it is created. So RNase H, what RNase H can do is that RNase H removes the primer. So it continues to remove the primer up to the last ribonucleotide left. So it continues to remove the primer from the 5 prime to 3 prime direction of the newly synthesizing DNA strand. And it removes the primer till the last ribonucleotide left. And then comes FEN1 protein. FEN1 protein removes the last ribonucleotide, plus it also removes some of the DNA sequences as well. So let me take another color to explain this better. Okay, so it also cleaves some of these DNA sequences as well. Okay, and once that thing is done, then the DNA ligase will seal the nick. So this blue colored region of the DNA, this particular part of the DNA, this is all DNA. This is no RNA. The only RNA portion was there is this primer, which is cleaved out by the RNase H. Then FEN1 cleaves the last ribonucleotide along with some of the DNA as well. And then the ligase will seal the nick. This is how the process works for an RNase H model. While the second model, a flap model, works something differently. The same situation again, the new DNA in blue color, the next Okazaki fragment in red color, and the RNA portion here, primer, is in green color. So now what happens exactly is the DNA polymerase delta is loaded, because this is the lagging strand we are talking about, along with helicase. Helicase continue to move and separate the strands from each other, and the DNA polymerase delta, the eukaryotic DNA polymerase delta, is loaded. And what it does actually, it elongates the new DNA from the 5 prime towards the 3 prime direction of the newly synthesizing DNA in the lagging strand. And during this process, it displaces the primer along with the next Okazaki fragment DNA. And then FEN1 or FEN1 cuts the DNA from a point here. So it cuts a portion of the DNA that carries the new DNA of Okazaki fragment along with the RNA primer region. Okay. So this portion is cleaved out by the FEN1. And then there is a missing phosphodiester bond that can be easily sealed with the help of DNA ligase, because DNA ligase can easily join the phosphodiester bond, right, with the process that we already discussed in case of prokaryotic DNA replication. So this is a flap model. So flap model is applicable for the lagging strands of the DNA, while the RNase H model is useful to explain the process in the leading strand of the DNA. So this is how this process is done. Okay.
So I believe you understood how the flap model works. Okay. So how they displaces the strand. Once that process is done, then again the gap is filled, the ligase will seal the nick. And once all these things are done, then comes the two more proteins, NAP1 and CAP1. NAP1 means nucleosome assembly protein 1, and CAP1 means chromatin assembly factor 1. So what they are doing here, NAP1 and CAP1, both of them, the NAP1 protein is bringing the histones from the cytosol inside the nucleus. Okay, it's very, very important. Try to understand that. Because after the process is done, the DNA need to be wrapped around the histone. And the histone proteins are also already built in the cytosol. Okay, because the protein synthesis takes place in the cytosol. So the histones are brought inside the nucleus by the NAP protein or nucleosome assembly protein 1. This is the escort proteins that will bring or escort the histone proteins inside the nucleus. And then this CAP protein or chromatin assembly factor 1 allows the DNA to be wrapped around the histone. And that's how they complete the process of the DNA replication. Now, in this elongation video, I'm talking about this termination process, because in the termination video itself, I have a big process to deal with, and that is the end, protecting the end of the chromosome from degradation. That is the telomere replication and end replication problem. So try to understand, NAP will bring the histones inside, CAF will add the DNA wrapped around the histone, and that's how the process kind of going towards the conclusion. And that is all about the eukaryotic DNA replication elongation. If you like this video, please hit the like button, share this video with your friends, and subscribe to our channel to get more videos like that. And obviously watch the third part, that is the termination of DNA replication in eukaryotes, in the next video. Bye.